Emo is tough to define. As Andy Greenwald wrote in Nothing Feels Good, emo means different things to different people. Actually, that's a massive understatement. Emo seems solely to mean different things to different people. But for the most part, it's more of an insult than a genre. And because of this, no band willingly considers themselves emo. However, at its essence, it's an offshoot of punk that is in touch with its more introspective feelings. Maybe the guitars twinkle, maybe the guitars smash you over the head. The key element is there needs to be emotion, sung from the very bottom of their heart. But how did it get from its original emotional hardcore guise to the music featured on the OC? What were the essential steps along the way? And why is My Chemical Romance referred to as emo? This is how emo became emo. Emo emerged from the hardcore punk scene. Hardcore had taken punk and made it leaner, more aggressive, faster, and removed any kind of melody that couldn't be hollered along to. The lyrics of bands like Black Flag, Bad Brains, and Minor Threat dealt mostly with anger, violence, and anti-authority sentiment. Partly because of this, by the mid-80s, the scene had become full of meatheads, as well as needlessly violent and sexist. Some acts, though, didn't conform to this version of hardcore. California's Descendants sang about girls and breakups. Why can't you say you talk to me? Though mostly with barely disguised anger. Minnesota's Husker Du kicked back against the strictures of hardcore as early as 1983's It's Not Funny Anymore. Play what you wanna play. While Zen Arcade would include moments of vein-bulging emotion, an unexpected melody. Never talking to you again. I'm never talking to you. Formed in Washington, D.C. in 1984, Rites of Spring took the passion and speed of hardcore and added melodies, vulnerability, and lyrics that looked inward. On their soul full-length released on Discord in 1985, the vocals of Guy Picciotto weren't hollers or shouts, but intensely poetic pleas. Live, they would play to the limits of their physical endurance, often trashing their instruments in their emotional fervor. Other DC-based punks would follow suit, heralding what would be known as the Revolution Summer, creating their own version of this emotional hardcore. Bands like Grey Matter, Beefeater, Dag Nasty, and Embrace. Embrace was a massive reason that we became a melodic band with singable melodies. That was a massive reason why all the bands in that era sounded like they sounded. It was so much of Embrace. They were beautiful and sad and melodic and cool. Led by former Minor Threat frontman Ian MacKay, Embrace would be the first of these bands to be written about as emocore by Brian Baker of Dag Nasty in Thrasher magazine, a half-insult, half-joke term that none of the Revolution Summer bands warmed to.
I must say, emocore must be the stupidest fucking thing I've ever heard in my entire life. Emotional hardcore, as if hardcore wasn't emotional to begin with.
These bands wouldn't last, having all disintegrated by the end of 1986. Fugazi would form out of the ashes of Rites of Spring and Embrace. Over the next decade, with their rhythmic post-hardcore and independent spirit, they would become a touchstone for pretty much every emo band. While they themselves were never truly emo. While While it's a bit of a stretch to call the Smiths emo, or even proto-emo, frontman Morrissey's lyrical approach helped break down the barriers that most 80s music had erected against vulnerability. Rather than the impersonal drama and icy detachment of other 80s British pop bands, the Smiths weren't afraid to let feelings of helplessness and low self-esteem take center stage. It's often clear from the song titles alone. But heaven knows I'm miserable now. And of course, there's the protagonist of How Soon Is Now, who sums up the Smiths' pain and longing in just two simple lines. Morrissey's willingness to let his guard down is perhaps the Smiths' most enduring element, one that is readily apparent in bands like Braid, Death Cab for Cutie, Owen and Cursive, all of whom had covered Smith songs. In the USA, the Replacements had become one of the most unrestrained and powerful rock and roll bands in American music history. But even early in their career, it was obvious that frontman Paul Westerberg's wounded but romantic heart was desperately trying to be heard above the din. Androgynous from 1984's otherwise window-rattling album Let It Be details the pain and hope of a gender-fluid couple as they're either forced into traditional roles or mocked for being their true selves. Androgynous, as well as other Replacement songs, the skyway prove that there could be room for both vulnerability and volume in the same band. Also one of the first alternative bands to sign to a major, the Replacements would blow a major hole in the wall between the rock underground and the mainstream, a wall that would eventually be obliterated with the success of Nirvana in 1991. Nirvana's breakthrough was a significant event in the development of emo. Their commercial success meant that more alternative and punk-flavored groups would get major label deals and mainstream attention, ultimately leading to Green Day's pop-punk smash hit, Dookie, in 1994. Originally from New York before relocating to the hive of punk activity that was the Bay Area in California, Jawbreaker snugly fit into two camps. They took the bookish indie rock of REM and the Smiths and added it to hardcore, serrated guitars and double time rhythms. From as early as 1990's Want, singer Blake Schwarzenbach's grizzled, whiskey-soaked voice emoted the full range of the heart like no other in punk. A power he almost completely lost in 1992 due to developing polyps on his vocal cords. Just before getting them surgically removed, he recorded their signature tune, Kiss the Bottle. The pain and regret behind his wordplay, all too audible. Dude, you have no idea. When we all lived in one big house in El Paso and had no careers or clue, we would sit around drinking all day listening to this song and sing along. You wake up to an empty night. Tears for two. With a new cleaner voice tone, Jawbreaker would return with their opus, 24-Hour Revenge Therapy, a breakup in 11 parts. Furthering the cult of Blake with the post-divorce remembrances of Ashtray Monument. And the disintegrating romance of Jinx Removing. Jinx Removing captures the contradiction and the agony of being in something that you realize may not live. What can you do with that? It's not that you don't love the person, or completely want them, or need them, but you also know that it's not going to work. That's a really agonizing position to be in. After tours with Nirvana and Green Day, the band signed to major label DGC in 1995 and released Dear You. The faithful hated it, called the band sellouts, and the band split up soon after, but has since become a classic in its own right. While pop punkier tracks like Bad Scene, Everyone's Fault, why is it always like this? Would lead to Saves the Day and Fall Out Boy. The album would also house the moody darkness of Accident Prone. If I go, don't forget one good thing I almost did. A particular favourite of modern emo singer-songwriter Julian Baker. After the Revolution Summer, a handful of bands continued on with the emo core sound into the 90s. From Maryland, Moss Icon. California's Indian Summer. And New Jersey's Policy of Free. But aside from maybe Jawbreaker, the band who would be most important to 90s emo is Seattle's Sunny Day Real Estate. Powered by the motive force of 18-year-old Jeremy Enoch, his cracked falsetto codified the emo hallmark that no one could really sing. But that it was vital that they sing, with all their being, their heart, their soul. This was twinned with a crunching heft, guitars alternately twinkling and bludgeoning. Signed by Fluke after having played their second ever show to one person, and that person happened to be a very impressed Jonathan Poneman of Sub Pop. The band released Diary in 1994, a month after the death of Kurt Cobain. They brought a teenage romance to the genre, an optimism that things might work out, despite evidence to the contrary. They toured nationally in support slots to small crowds, and the band split up soon after, in part because Enoch had found religion, as he foreshadowed in Song About an Angel. But even after their collapse, they managed to get their fair share of MTV play, with videos 7 and In Circles, as a byproduct of the grunge explosion, exposing this music to the next generation. I think Sunny Day Real Estate and their first record, Diary, was the first kind of catalyst. Everyone knew Sunny Day Real Estate. There was a depth to them that I felt like a lot of punk rock that I had heard didn't have. Due to the post-Nirvana gold rush, several emo-adjacent groups got swept up by major labels, frantically trying to acquire the next big thing. Perhaps the only band to make the jump from the fiercely independent Discord label to a major, in this case Atlantic, Jawbox took full advantage of their increased studio time to perfect the ample layers of jagged guitar on 1994 single Savory. With a groove and sensuality rarely heard in emo, the track somehow was featured on that 90s institution, Beavis and Butthead.
Well, she's like saying things. How does she do that?
Here, I'll show you, Beavis.
One of the more adventurous signings to the majors was Drive Like Jehu, which Interscope snapped up at the same time as John Speedo Reese's other more commercial band, the punk and roll A Rocket from the Crypt. A discordant pileup of Fugazi dynamics and Wiper's twisted riff appreciation. Here comes the Rome Plows, from their sole major label release. 1994's Yank Crime brought time signature fuckery and bile coated hollers to the post hardcore stew. Preempting At the Drive-In and Thursday. Sacramento's Far emerged from the same scene as Deftones, and as such were signed to the same epic imprint as new metal bands Korn and Incubus. But on a song like the slow-burning eruption of Job's Eyes from 1996. It was clear they were a very different beast. Some consider its parent LP, Tin Cans With Strings To You, to be the first screamo album, Jonah Matranga's harsh vocals expelling his impassioned lyrics. But not all bands succumbed to the lure of the majors. Colorado's Christie Front Drive created emotive mini-epics that swung between shimmering ambience and crushing distortion. After hearing Slide in 1995, a junior talent scout at Capitol Records attempted to sign the band. They rejected his advances, preferring to release via a collection of respected indies. As Slide had been one side of a split 7-inch, the scout flipped the record and signed the other band as a substitute. Christie Front Drive went on to be a cult band in the emo movement, an inspiration for the Midwest scene, before breaking up in 1997. The band on the B-side was Jimmy Eat World. More on them later. Emo's time in the mainstream spotlight would quickly evaporate, again moving underground. Bands playing basement shows in their close-knit communities, with word-of-mouth zines and relentless touring being the only way to get your band known. Coming out of the New Jersey hardcore scene, Lifetime were a rapid-fire assault. Songs chugging, battering, and stampeding, but rarely reaching 2 minutes in length. The differentiating element was frontman Ari Katz's snotty yet impassioned holler, lending their hardcore a melodic edge and hopeless romanticism. Amongst the anthems encased within their second album, Hello Bastards, Katz leads you through romantic disarray within a basement show on Rodeo Clown. Heart-rending sincerity in an imperfect relationship on Irony Is For Suckers. And lingers on his own indecision on the four repeated words of I'm Not Calling You. Released on Jade Tree, its impressive sales for an indie release would help the label thrive in the latter half of the 90s, putting out essential albums by The Promise Ring, Jets to Brazil, and Joan of Arc. Hello Bastards would remain an urtext for New Jersey and Long Island melodic hardcore and emo. I feel like that band saved my life. I picked up Hello Bastards and was just like, that's it. I might as well have written it, or they might as well have written it about me. Another band to emerge from hardcore, this time from the ashes of New York Krishnacore groups Shelter, 108, and Resurrection, was Texas Is The Reason, getting their name from a Misfits lyric. Texas is the reason, not the president's name. The band released a self-titled EP in late 1995. In opener, If It's There When We Get Back, It's Ours. The hardcore speed, overlong title, and questioning sensitive lyrics. Got the band instant underground admirers and copyists. The following year's Do You Know Who You Are would consolidate this status, with several of the song titles continuing the theming of the band's name in referencing aspects of the conspiracies that surrounded the JFK assassination.
We've come to know it as the magic bullet theory. Back and to the left. Back and to the left.
Garrett Klahn's plaintive vocal, a halfway between Liam Gallagher and Modest Mouse's Isaac Brock, imbues even the harder, faster songs like Back and to the Left with a sense of nostalgic romance. Even if it's about New York City rather than a lost love. Despite being courted by major labels, interband tensions meant that the band would split up soon after. One band to do very well in the aftermath of grunge was Weezer. 1994's self-titled album, popularly known as the Blue Album, featured three MTV hits and went multiple times platinum. In frontman Rivers Cuomo, they had a songwriter who knew his way around a melody, but was also not afraid to write about his romantic fuck-ups. Blues Track Order shows this beautifully, moving from the unreasonable and possessive No One Else. To the Why Have You Left Me lament of The World Has Turned and Left Me Here. Rather than continue down the path of lightly distorted power pop, on 1996's Pinkerton, the band went full In Utero. Raw, confessional, and at some points atonal, the record is Cuomo full-on vomiting his most intimate thoughts and desires. It features a whole lot of self-loathing. I'm tired of having sex, so tired. Wild fantasies prompted by a letter from a young fan. And with lead single El Scorcho, Cuomo relentlessly stalking a crush, to the point of reading their diary. So I went to your room and read your diary. It is uncomfortable how open it is, like we are listening to Cuomo's own diary read aloud, and so was not what people wanted after the Buddy Hollies of the Blue Album. It barely sold, critics hated it, and Cuomo would disappear for 5 years. Later claiming it to be a hideous record, it was such a hugely painful mistake. But due to word of mouth and the increased importance of internet message boards, Pinkerton became a cult classic, its oversharing nature seeping into future emo bands. Not only that, but from a more aesthetic point of view, the geek chic 90s emo uniform of thick rimmed glasses and comfy sweater was taken directly from Cuomo. Weezer weren't the only mid-90s band who weren't quite emo that still had a major impact on its sound. Superchunk tracks like the crunchy yet fleet-footed Detroit Has a Skyline. Were calling points for Christy Front Drive and the Get Up Kids. Modest Mouse's countrified indie with hints of math rock on Dramamine. Can be heard in American Football and the Emo Revival. Blink-182 even had a song called Emo. It's okay to just want more. Not only increasing recognition of the term, but also being a touchstone for the nasal, pop-punk leaning side of the genre. In the latter half of the 90s, Midwest emo surfaced. And like everything in emo, it is hotly debated. For the most part, it took the quiet, loud dynamics of grunge and contrasted pretty, twinkling guitar work with chunky, distorted chords. It was generally mid-tempo, and though arguably invented by Washington State's Sunny Day Real Estate, it was codified in the Midwest of the United States, which gives it its name. From Illinois, a bunch of teenagers under the moniker Captain Jazz released a single album in June 1995. It had a 28-word title that was far too long to remember, It barely sold due to indie label Man With Gun printing too few copies, and the band split up soon after, but with inarticulate, jangling whirlwinds like Little Leak. And the Jade Tree re-release of their back catalogue in 1998. They would forevermore be seen as the godfathers of the subgenre. I would say 90% of the lyrics on that record were all written in one night. The first time I ever took mushrooms and sat by a campfire. Yeah, it was just, the whole record, lyrically, was just this one night in the woods in Wisconsin. Mineral bucked the Midwest trend by being from Texas. But their sunny day style dynamics, shoegazy textures, and Chris Simpson's raw, pained voice, and I can still taste, made them, and especially their 1995 debut single Gloria, essential to the movement. Only managing to put out two LPs before collapsing, the near instant influence of that first 7-inch would inspire the name of Simpson's next band. After the collapse of Captain Jazz, guitarist Davey Von Bohlen would return as the singer of The Promise Ring. As much as it is a trope of emo that singers can't really sing, Von Bohlen really can't sing. But it makes their slower songs like a picture postcard. Don't forget to kiss me. Where the protagonist is trying desperately to prolong his relationship, even if it's by minutes, all the more affecting. Couldn't you take the second bus home? Releasing their debut, 30 Degrees Everywhere, in 1996 on Jade Tree, its mix of jangly indie rock and heart-shredding crunch managed to sell tens of thousands of copies. As the band was still, for the most part, playing basements, this was huge. Their follow-up, 1997's Nothing Feels Good, also on Jade Tree, did even better. The bubbly sigh of tracks like Red and Blue Jeans, and a video for Why Did Ever We Meet being shown on MTV's 120 Minutes. Allowed the band to sail to the top of the Midwest pack. Von Bohlen would later guest on Jimmy Eat World's A Praise Chorus, on Emo's true mainstream breakthrough album. As a less than subtle nod to how important The Promise Ring were to everything after. Jade Tree was not the only important emo label. Based in Champaign, Illinois, Polyvinyl had their fair share of Midwest classics in their back catalog. Wisconsin's Raina Maria released their debut, Past Worn Searching, on the label in 1987. An arty, often atonal spin on the formula, with its opener, Tinfoil, twisting and turning on a dime. The mere presence of frontwoman Caitlin Demarai in the Midwest scene kicked back against emo's Boys Only Club, showing that women could exist as more than just subject matter, while delivering lines just as fraught as any of her male contemporaries. Braid, though, were the band that got Polyvinyl on the map, and funded the label for the near future. From Illinois, but obsessed with the Washington DC bands for the first two albums, it wouldn't be until they signed with Polyvinyl for album 3 that they secured their place in the emo pantheon. On 1998's Frame and Canvas, lyricist Bob Nana distilled the essence of what Brand New and Dashboard Confessional would leap on in a few years' time.
Dozen roses in the car, and I don't know where you are. Maybe I don't know what I'm doing.
It was Waiting by the Phone angst, provoked by the homesickness of a particularly tense tour, separated from his girlfriend. The yearning that powered the Replacements' answering machine.
How do you say okay to an answering machine?
But dumbed down so any adolescent male missed her too.
Oh, I already miss you, sing like the over the phone.
The album's centerpiece, A Dozen Roses, bounces, crunches, whispers and shouts in a delightfully bitter, hook-filled package. But punk rock standoffishness remained. Instead of putting their best song on frame and canvas, Forever Got Shorter was relegated to a limited run, Get Up Kids split. Dooming it to obscurity until the 2000 movie music compilations. Another heavyweight emo label is Deep Elm. From 1997 to 2004, the New York City label curated 10 editions of the Emo Diaries, a compilation series that provided previously unreleased music from Jimmy Eat World, the Appleseed cast, Further Seems Forever, The Jazz June, and many other bands, often unsigned. It played an undeniably large role in defining the public perception of emo. Although in true emo fashion, Deep Elm denied that they were trying to define anything. However, that didn't stop them from calling their 11th entry Taking Back What's Ours when they resurrected the series in 2007. One of Deep Elm's earliest acts was Illinois' Planes Mistaken for Stars. Unlike most of their contemporaries, they had a strong element of heavier, more traditional rock and roll. Copper and Stars, the first track on their self-titled debut EP, starts off with a pummeling riff that's closer to early 90s sub-pop acts like Tad or Love Battery than anything identifiably emo. When the song proper kicks in, Garrett O'Donnell's vocals have a strong Paul Westerberg vibe. And the music walks the line between old school punk and a revved up Thin Lizzy. This difference attracted a lot of attention outside emo circles, leading to tours with such non-emo bands as the Dillinger Escape Plan and sleep mastermind Matt Pike's High on Fire. Another Deep Elm artist is Kansas's The Appleseed Cast, led by vocalist Christopher Creasy. The band took their boilerplate emo sound into broader, more atmospheric directions. Forever Longing, The Golden Sunsets, from their second album, Mere Vitalis, takes a breathless passion that is recognizably emo. And wraps it in a crystalline sound that owes as much to UK acts like The Chameleons and Kitchens of Distinction as it does to emo's US punk and hardcore roots. Despite being signed to a major label, Capitol did little to further Jimmy Eat World's career. 1996's Static Prevails had been beset by label interference, but barely sold. However, it did gain them a fan in Blink-182's Tom DeLonge, as Episode 4 would be his wedding song.
We'll dance off time to the songs we've never liked.
And a collection of Sunny Day-style jams. In February 1999, the band released Clarity, Their second album for Capitol would benefit, at least initially, by the label ignoring the band completely, leaving them free to do whatever they wanted. As a result, they recorded some of the most heartbreakingly beautiful songs in the emo canon. Clarity makes you feel a certain way. You can put it on and no matter what you're feeling, nothing goes through your head. Everything stops. It's just unreal. Every single emotion that a person can go through is captured on that CD. The album is not just emotionally diverse, but sonically as well. Alongside the Midwest emo style tracks like Blister, there would be the low indebted chamber pop of Table for Glasses, the glitchy electro-pop of 12-23-95, and the epic 16-minute long Goodbye Sky Harbor. With its euphoric, dream pop, extended outro. On the emo power ballad, For Me This Is Heaven, they attempted to layer as much hand percussion as they could afford, ranging from vibes and temple blocks to multiple pitches of cowbell. They were wheeling in timpani when we realized we had taken it a little too far. I could be wrong, but this may be the only Jimmy Eat World song with triangle. You can lose yourself in your courage. Though Lucky Denver Mint would get some modern rock airplay. You're not bigger than this, not better, why can't you learn? And be used in the Drew Barrymore rom-com Never Been Kissed. The album as a whole would fail to sell. A year later, Jimmy Eat World would be dropped by Capitol. But in the same way that Diary was the start point of second wave emo, Clarity signaled the beginning of wave 3. American football were assembled at the University of Illinois in 1997 by Captain Jazz and Joan of Arc drummer Mike Kinsella, taking to the frontman position with a borrowed guitar. Initially a side project, opposed to the Midwestern scene and inspired by minimalist composer Steve Reich, they took a post-rock and jazz approach. All tangled spiderweb guitars, cavernous 6-4 drums, with the occasional mournful trumpet augment. The band would release an EP in 1998 and their self-titled full-length in September 1999, both via polyvinyl. The lyrics, Kinsella took lines directly from his teenage journal, mostly about a devastating breakup he experienced when he was 17. Goodbye. On Never Meant, he attempts to console himself after his world had fallen out beneath him. Though it was critically praised, their self-titled album barely sold, and the band split up soon after. We knew when we were recording our debut album that we were going to break up. We had never had any ambitious goals. We weren't kids who wanted to jump in the van and tour all summer. Nowadays, everyone who argues about emo on the internet knows American football. They are considered perhaps the most important of the Midwest emo bands. Never Meant is so iconic, it's a meme. But that wasn't always the case. The definitive work on emo circa 2003, Nothing Feels Good, doesn't mention them. Not once. It was only after the internet rediscovered American football from the mid-2000s onwards that they started to get held up as a pivotal band in the emo story. When the album was re-released in 2014, it not only crashed the polyvinyl website, but it also managed to get all the way to number 68 on the Billboard 200. As emo bands started to sell progressively more, one indie label made it their mission to cash in. led by the taste of Rich Egan. Vagrant Records used punk rhetoric and major label strategy to sell emo to the masses. Founded in 1994, by the end of the decade, they had cornered the market. The Get Up Kids from Missouri released their first album, 4 Minute Mile, on Doghouse in 1997. Singer Matt Pryor accurately described it as swinging dance numbers about crying. Though some saw them as merely poor Superchunk imitations, 4 Minute Mile still sold 15,000 copies. After being signed to Vagrant, the band took a massive step up with 1999's Something to Write Home About. Thanks to their new label's roomier budget, they were able to double down on polishing the hooks present on their debut and fire out Foo Fighters level anthems in the form of Action and Action. Every mistake that I make, couldn't have made without you. In 10 minutes. Opener Holiday charmingly wrong-foots you, bursting with uplifting chords and the synth add-ons of James DeWeese. Despite being a bittersweet recounting of a long-term friendship's deterioration. The album managed to make the Billboard Heatseekers chart, peaking at number 31, and the band would tour with Green Day and Weezer. By 2002, it had sold 10 times the amount of its predecessor. With this increased visibility, the Get Up Kids' fizzy emo pop would influence the likes of Newfound Glory, Fall Out Boy, and the Wonder Years, and encourage other bands to make the move to Vagrant. Saves the Day were another important band for Vagrant. Released by hardcore label Equal Vision, 1999's Through Being Cool took the formula devised by Lifetime, hardcore tunes with melody and a beating heart. Last night I kept you cold, and buffed it to a pop shine. Connolly's adolescently morbid lyrics would inspire the melodramatic and often graphic words of the next generation. Let me take this awkward song, run it up against your thighs. What is Taking Back Sunday's Your So Last Summer? Truth. You could slip my throat. But more descriptive rewriting of rock tonic juice magic. Critics may scoff at such juvenile sentiment, but as a teenager, getting your heart broken feels like the end of the world. Zeroing in on that high school mentality allowed Through Being Cool to sell 50,000 copies. Following the Get Up Kids, they too signed to Vagrant and would make number 100 on the Billboard 200 with their 2001 follow-up, Stay What You Are. Though here, instead of having his heart stomped on, Connolly fantasizes about his layabout friend's funeral. Vagrant would snag other promising prospects. Bob Nana's new band Hey Mercedes. The keyboard-driven emo of Kansas's The Anniversary. And the jawbreaker riffing Alkaline Trio. However, their biggest coup would be a hardcore kid from Florida, armed with an acoustic guitar and a glove box full of feelings. But that's slightly later. By the end of the decade, emo in all shapes and forms was popping up all over the US. Piebald hailed from Massachusetts. Although they shared a scene with darker, more severe bands like Cave-In, and Converge. Piebald injected their tough, stripped-down sound. And that's more than a dress. You can see my benefit. Oh yeah. With flashes of light-hearted humor. even going so far as to give their second album a dad joke for a title. If it weren't for Venetian blinds, it would be curtains for us all. Humor aside, the first track, Grace Kelly with Wings, effortlessly combines emo signifiers with Descendants-style pop punk. And opens with a lyric that captures the emo mindset in 10 short words.
And that's more than a dress. It's a Grace Kelly movie.
Nebraska's Cursive had to split up and reform before they found their stride. After two solid but relatively unremarkable albums, the band split up when vocalist Tim Kasher decided to get married. Uncoincidentally, the split lasted exactly as long as the marriage did, and the reunion album Domestica was loosely based on Cash's divorce and all the apparent bitterness it caused. There's a harsher atonality in the television-esque dueling guitars of Kasher and Ted Stevens. Which adds a dark, queasy undercurrent to the acidity of the martyr.
Your tears are all the alibis to prove you still feel. You only feel sorry for yourself.
Elliot from Kentucky had a direct connection to emo's roots. They were signed to hardcore label Revelation Records, although their sound bears virtually no resemblance to other Revelation acts like Quicksand or Gorilla Biscuits. Even by emo standards, there's a softness to vocalist Chris Higdon's delivery that contains as much resignation as passion.
And I'm here, and I'm special.
When the melodramatically titled Lipstick Stigmata hits its climax, it's done with restraint, rather, catharsis. The Juliana Theory was formed almost by accident. Initially a vaguely defined side project by a group of friends from southwest Pennsylvania, it quickly became everyone's main focus. If I told you this was killing me, would you stop? From their 2000 album, Emotion is Dead, distilled everything about what emo was becoming, as it inched closer to mainstream acceptance. Loud, quiet dynamics, bratty vocals with tight harmonies, soaring slabs of guitar, and a chorus that sneaks up on you from behind.
Watch your mouth, hold your tongue.
The band's timing wasn't quite right, however. They had moved past much of their emo roots when they signed to Epic Records and released Love in 2003. And although it sold relatively well, the Juliana Theory were emo only in name. Taking their name from the chorus of a hair metal song. Texas's At the Drive-In had spent the second half of the 90s creating adventurous and evocative post-hardcore. Earning comparisons with Fugazi and the MC5. By 2000, the band were on the verge of combustion, and it all came down to how to evolve their sound. Half the band were all about screaming, discordant riff-a-rama, while the other half would rather have a more traditional emo-punk sound. The outcome was the Ross Robinson-produced Relationship of Command, which, despite internal tensions, is a cool melding of the two points of view. Its jagged, explosive lead single, One Arm Scissor, a space oddity with start-stop dynamics,
dissect a trillion miles away. Will you get this letter?
And a visceral chorus. Was one of the first post-hardcore songs to get international exposure. Its music video would get ample play on MTV2, and their haphazard, destructive, and often off-key live appearances on The Conan O'Brien Show, Australia's The Joint, and the BBC's Jules Holland Show would excite and confuse viewers. The latter would include frontman Cedric Bixler Zavala hurling a found chair around the stage with reckless abandon. It was only at the end of the performance that it is revealed that he'd stolen it from unamused pop star Robbie Williams.
Can we mate on his chair back, please?
Soon after, the band would rupture into two parts, the more experimental two forming the Mars Volta. While the rest assembled Sparta. After over a decade in basements and on independent labels, emo was starting to bleed through into the pop charts. A major factor was due to emo lifers, Jimmy Eat World. After being dropped by Capitol, they decided to self-fund the recording of their next album, in the hope that another label would jump in to release it. It was a risky move, but after they collected together 11 tracks of the finest quality, emotive pop rock, DreamWorks were more than happy to serve it to the masses. The result was Bleed American, released in July 2001, in the same way that Smells Like Teen Spirit broke grunge into the mainstream. Its second single, The Middle, not only launched Jimmy Eat World into the public spotlight, but the entirety of emo too. In part, it was the right song for the moment. It may have been written to comfort a fan having a tough time at school. But as it was released as a single less than 2 months after the September 11th attacks, its peppy chorus reached through the radio. It just takes some time, little girl, and little out the right. And gave people solace in a very confusing and traumatic time. As such, by June 2002, The Middle had crept to number 5 on the Billboard Hot 100. A genuine pop hit. Back in 2000, Florida band Further Seems Forever were in the process of writing their debut record. Their singer had been bringing songs to rehearsals, but they were too soft for the former hardcore project. Their label, Tooth & Nail, had set aside some studio time that the band weren't ready to use. Instead, their singer, Chris Caraba, went in with an acoustic guitar and recorded the whole of his debut, The Swiss Army Romance. Sleep with all the sheets off, bearing your mattress. That was the start of Dashboard Confessional. Like Braid and Saves the Day before him, he was getting the adolescent romantic experience, all the jealousy and bitterness, and translating it to song. Cuddling close to blankets and sheets, but you're not alone. You're not discreet. Screaming Infidelities is about listening to sad songs. As for now, gonna hear the saddest songs. To deflect your own sadness about an unfaithful lover. Sit alone and wonder how you're making out. His full lung sing-along coda, though, would be the element that would convert a generation. In downtime, Caraba would tour with bands like Hatebreed, The Movie Life and Thursday, going on as a support. There weren't many hardcore kids playing acoustic guitar back then. I think that made people instantly curious, or instantly hate me. Probably for life too. But through this relentless getting the word out, and his MP3s being traded via Napster, he built his own significant following. As such, Vagrant signed him for album 2, The Places You Have Come to Fear the Most, released in March 2001. By the end of 2002, Caraba was doing Dashboard Confessional full-time, had played MTV Unplugged, and everyone of high school age knew and had an opinion on Chris Caraba. The success of Dashboard Confessional made the kids look for other sensitive souls with acoustic instrumentation, which as well as the Saddle Creek twang of Bright Eyes. would lead them to Def Cab for Cutie. Def Cab had existed since 1997. They did not have a punk rock background, their key influences being indie rockers Built to Spill, Pavement, and Codeine. By 2001's The Photo Album, by various comparisons to other similarly weepy bands, they had attained the emo tag. The album's pinnacle is the scenic movie script ending. It's jangly Midwestern riffs, entangled in Ben Gibbard's sober account of his return home to Seattle after getting his heart squashed. I ended up in Los Angeles for love. At the time, I would have moved to Siberia. When you're that goofy in love, you'll move to Siberia. In 2003, the song would be used in the season 1 episode of Fox's hugely successful teen drama, The OC.
Listening to this music.
Hey, do not insult Def Cab.
It's like one guitar and a whole lot of complaining.
And a new audience would discover Def Cab for Cutie, due to them being Seth Cohen's favorite band. Emo was seeping into popular culture. Meanwhile, in basements all over New Jersey and Long Island, a new breed of bands rose to the surface. Sure, there was the hardcore slanted Glassjaw. But most groups learnt their trade from listening and replicating fellow scene bands. Lifetime, Texas Is the Reason, and Saves the Day. New Jersey's Thursday were also an exception. Having been playing since 1997, their sound recalled the intense poetic pleas and clashing off-kilter guitars, a Rites of Spring and At the Drive-In. Jeff Rickley's lyrics were abstract, but still the urgency of his delivery conveyed everything. Though 2001's Full Collapse, issued by Victory Records, would be their breakout, in its first week, it sold only 800 copies. Lead track, Understanding in a Car Crash, references Neil Young.
I've seen the needle and the damage done.
The needle and the damage done.
And chronicles in detail the trauma of an automotive accident.
I can see the headlights coming. They paint the world in red and broken glass.
Due to its cloaked metaphors, it was more than just the breakups of Dashboard Confessional. But the words still had a melancholy, almost Smith's quality, that their teenage audience adored. Through kind words from Chris Carrabba, constant touring, and the resultant fanbase murmurings on message boards, Thursday slowly climbed to the lower reaches of the Billboard 200 in April 2002, a year after the album's release. This caused the rock press to take notice and panic. How could a band they'd never heard of achieve such a feat? Two bands that had their careers entwined were Brand New and Taking Back Sunday, both from Long Island. Taking Back Sunday started first, forming in 99, though it took a while to get a stable lineup. An early bassist was Jesse Lacey, a childhood friend of the core members of the group. Lacey would leave after 3 months, incensed by guitarist John Nolan having romanced his girlfriend at a party. In the aftermath, Lacey would form Brand New. This event left its jealous fingerprints all over the two bands' respective debut albums. Released in October 2001, on Brand New's Your Favorite Weapon, most of Lacey's scorn for Nolan is spat out with 70x7. John Nolan would hit back at Lacey with Taking Back Sundays, There's No I in Team, which steals a couple of lyrics from Brand New songs, reappropriating them and launching them back at their writer, similar to hip-hop feud response songs.
Is that what you call tact? You're as subtle as a brick and the small on my back.
But Nolan wasn't the only target of Lacey's ire. Throughout, he bitterly condemns former beaux, especially on lead single Jude Law and A Semester Abroad.
Even if we're playing
where he drunkenly imagines violent death on a girlfriend that dared to study in England and break off their relationship. By this point, emo was embodying the same violent and sexist attributes that the Revolution Summer bands had opposed. While Jesse Lacey and Brand New had a pivotal influence on the mainstreaming of emo, we must also address the allegations leveled at him by multiple women, detailing years of sexual exploitation, most of which started when the women were underage and Lacey was in his 20s. In response, Lacey apologized and released a statement saying he used sex as a coping method and was a habitual cheater. Often, one can separate art from the artist, but Lacey's frankly gross treatment of women in his music makes that impossible. Taking Back Sunday took longer to release their debut. Appearing in March 2002 via Victory Records, Tell All Your Friends took Lifetime's melodic hardcore and the hookiness of The Promise Ring, and layered on top the almost b-boy style vocal interplay of Adam Lazara and Nolan. The way that we just had so many words and always found a way to rhythmically make it work, I think had something to do with listening to a lot of Jay-Z at that point. Lazara in particular was a fiery live presence, famed for his acrobatic mic swinging, to an extent that it's a miracle that he didn't concuss more of his bandmates. The lyrics, as always, were about relationships. Such as Cute Without the E, Cut From the Team, a tale of being romantically used. With imagery of lipstick, napkins, and guns, this launched the band to the big leagues. Tell All Your Friends went gold in the US, and was a mainstream crossover point for the scene. The same year Taking Back Sunday broke through, Jeff Rickley was in the studio producing the debut album for a new band from New Jersey, one that had formed as a direct reaction to the 9/11 attacks. They were a cosmic gumbo of the Misfits' horror obsession, Iron Maiden's dueling metal riffs, and Thursday's impassioned post-hardcore. That album was I Brought You My Bullets, You Brought Me Your Love. And that band was My Chemical Romance. In the 2 years between My Chemical Romance's debut and their follow-up, this new emo sound continued its assault on the lower reaches of the charts. But Three Cheers for Sweet Revenge monopolized on the progress of Saves the Day, Jimmy Eat World, Dashboard Confessional, and Taking Back Sunday, and made themselves the popular ideal of what an emo band looked and sounded like. A concept album of sorts, the narrative involves lovers separated by death, a Faustian pact, and the souls of a thousand evil men. And while the main storyline would make Tarantino balk for being too over the top, the record also deals with some very sensitive topics, like addiction, suicide, and depression, in a very relatable manner. The scream-along chorus of I'm Not Okay, I Promise, belies the song's comment on sexual manipulation. And the lack of empathy of teen angst, where everyone else's problems don't matter in the face of your own adolescent struggles. While Helena reflects on the recent death of singer Gerard Way's grandmother and his regret that he was out on tour when she passed. It's really an angry open letter to myself, is about why I wasn't around for this woman who was so special to me. Why I wasn't there for the last year of her life. The imagination behind these widescreen ideas was indulged by the band's new major label, Reprise, the label that had elevated Green Day from Gilman Street urchins to the biggest thing in punk. Not only is the production by Howard Benson slick and radio ready, the album was marketed through the teeth, its three high budget videos becoming instant MTV staples. Helena hit number 33 on the Billboard Hot 100 and number 20 on the UK Singles Chart. Three Cheers was certified platinum less than a year after its release. And after this point, MCR and Emo were unstoppable. Emo in his new mainstream guise, Emo Pop if you will, would have its moment. Fall Out Boy, Panic at the Disco and Paramore would all have massive hits, while inspiring a new generation to pick up guitars. For those that argued that this wasn't really emo, the underground would soon be overflowing with mathy, Midwestern influenced fare. What some have dubbed the emo revival. The likes of Algernon, Cadwallader, Empire Empire, I Was a Lonely Estate, Hop Along, Everyone Everywhere, Into It Over It, Modern Baseball, Joyce Manor, The Hotelier, The World is a Beautiful Place and I Am No Longer Afraid to Die, and Snowing, to name just 10. If the constantly changing sound of emo, from The Revolution Summer to Dashboard Confessional, means anything, it's that every generation is a teenager once, has some overwhelming feelings that they need to get off their chest. And whether they can sing or not, they're going to try to emote every ounce of their heart. Their backing may be hardcore double time beats, acoustic strums, or a tangle of spindly, off-kilter guitar plucks. But their essential sentiment is the same. Do you feel how I'm feeling? Thanks for watching. So what important moments in emo did I inevitably miss? Let me know by commenting down below. To listen to all the songs featured, there's links to Apple Music and Spotify playlists on my Patreon. You don't have to contribute, it's just on there. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. And I would also like to shout out this month's new top tier supporters over on Patreon. Paul Tannenholz and Ononimus. Thanks so very much. And I will see you next week for a Christmas treat.